Welcome back to our visual scripting series. In this session, we're not just skimming the surface. We're diving deep into how our scripts behave from start to finish. Let's unpack the execution order, navigate through decision-making nodes, and explore how sequences and loops can supercharge your scripts. Execution order unraveled. Understanding the execution order in visual scripting is akin to feeling the rhythm of a song. It guides the flow and timing of your script's actions. Now let's take a look at an example of a graph designed to incrementally update text with each frame. I'll show you how to link the nodes so that this graph adds a value of 1 to a number, converts the sum into a string data type, and then outputs the value so that it can display on the text object. Number 1, Update Initiator Node. The Update node kickstarts our logic flow, executing linked logic with each new frame. It's the pulse that keeps the script's actions moving forward, ensuring that our numerical value can increment frame by frame. 2, Number, Set Variable. It receives the signal from the Update node and adjusts the number variable accordingly. This action isn't merely fetching a value, it's about actively setting or altering the number based on the sum calculated by the subsequent Add and Get Variable nodes. Number 3, Add, Increment Logic. The Add node is straightforward yet pivotal. It takes the current number and increases it by 1. With its B input set to 1, it ensures that every frame sees an increment to our ongoing count, effectively advancing our numerical value steadily over time. Number 4, Number, Get Variable. This node contrasts with the earlier number node by retrieving, not setting, the current value of our number variable. It acts as a memory recall, bringing the latest count forward for further processing. Number 5, Text, Update Display. The text node enters the flow commanded by the altered number variable, ready to update its displayed content. But there's a catch. Before the text component can present our number, the value must shift from a numerical format to a textual one, aligning with the component's requirements. Number 6, Data Convert, Type Transformation. Finally, the Data Convert node steps in to transition our updated count from a numerical to a string format. This conversion is crucial for ensuring that the text node can interpret and display the value correctly. The Data Convert node acts as a bridge, ensuring seamless communication between numerical calculations and textual display. The golden rule of execution order in visual scripting is simple. This flow starts with input ports on the left side of a node. It activates when certain triggers or conditions are met. Once these conditions are met, the node processes the input data and then activates the next node, passing the data forward to the next nodes. Make sure each node has all the necessary data and is ready before it sends information to the next node. This careful process ensures your script works well, with each part doing its job at the right time. Understanding decision-making nodes, directing your logic. Now that we understand the basic rule of execution order, let's look at some of the special nodes that can change the course of your logic flow. The decision-making nodes. These nodes, located in the control section of our node library, play a crucial role in your script. The if node, for example, is key in dividing your script's narrative. It has two different output paths, one marked true and the other false. Think of it as a crossroads. It determines which path to follow based on whether specific conditions are met or not. So going back to the previous example, let's say we want to add value logic and only have it happen when the user presses on this cute screen button. Here, we're using the screen image tap node to detect the tap on the button. It will trigger the next node when the targeted image is tapped. By linking it with the if node, you can set up a logic like this. When tapping on the image, the output value is true. Then it matches the input condition of the if node, which shows checked in its condition port. So while the true path is triggered, the false path is not. Then link it to the set number node and give it a test on our preview panel. See, it will only add 1 every time the user presses the button. streamlining actions with sequence nodes. Moving from the if node, let's talk about the sequence node. Unlike the if node, which only activates one output path per execution, the sequence node ensures that multiple actions occur one after another in a defined order. How the sequence node functions? Well, think of it as a playlist. When activated, it plays the first song or action. Only once that action is completed does it move on to the next one. Use this text updating example with a slight modification. Imagine you want to set up a sequence where initially one action is triggered by pressing a button. Then, after a 2-second pause, the next action begins. Here's how you set it up. Connect the true output of an if node to the sequence node. This setup ensures that when the button is pressed, meaning the condition, the first set of actions, or route 1, is activated. The following actions, or procedure 2, are set to kick in next. You can introduce a delay, say, wait for 2 seconds node, before moving on to subsequent steps, ensuring a timed gap between actions. Okay, testing the setup. Head to the preview panel to see this in action. Upon pressing the button, the value updates to 1 right away. Then, after a 2-second delay, procedure 2 activates, updating the value to 2. This sequence node is incredibly handy for ensuring a series of actions unfolding step by step, maintaining a clear and logical order. It's especially beneficial in complex scripts with multiple nodes, helping to avoid any mix-ups and ensure that everything occurs in the intended sequence. Leveraging for loop for swift repetitions. The for loop is a crucial node for executing rapid, repetitive actions, all condensed within the time frame of a single frame, making it exceptionally efficient. Setting up a for loop in your visual scripting environment involves a few key steps. Based on the node's properties shown in this image, here's how you can configure it for efficient looping. Number 1, enter trigger input. This is where you connect the action that initiates the loop. Any logic or node that leads to this enter port will start the loop's execution. For example, you might connect a screen image tap node's on image tapped output port to this input port to trigger the loop when the button is pressed. Number 2, break termination input. This input allows you to stop the loop prematurely based on a specific condition. If you have a scenario where the loop needs to end before completing all iterations, for example, if a certain condition is met, you can connect a logic node that triggers this break input. Number 3, I equals initial index. Set the starting point of your loop here. This value is where your loop will begin counting from. If you're starting your count from 0, which is common in many cases, you'd input 0 here. Number 4, I is less than condition for continuation. This field determines the loop's endpoint by keeping the loop running as long as I is less than the value you specify. Number 5, step incremental value. This specifies how much I increases with each iteration of the loop. In most cases, you'll set this to 1 in order to increment by 1 each time. However, you can just adjust this value based on how you want to count through your loop. For example, count by 3s. Suppose you want to execute a piece of logic that increments a score by 1, but 10 times instantly upon pressing a button. Here's how you'd set it up. Set the initial index I equals to 0. Set the condition I is less than to 10 to ensure the loop runs 10 times. Leave the step value at 1 for a standard count. After configuring these properties, link its output port called body to set number node. Now let's test it in our preview panel by pressing the button. See? The value jumps to 10 instantly. Understanding do n for controlled repetitions. In contrast, the do n node operates differently from the for loop. While it also focuses on repetition, do n spreads its executions across the entire lifecycle of the effect, rather than cramming them into a single frame. Configuring do n. You set the number of times n that an action should occur. For example, if you set do n with a parameter of 3, the linked action will only be triggered 3 times throughout the entire lifecycle of the effect. After these 3 activations, it will wait for a reset before it can trigger again. Both for loop and do end nodes offer unique approaches to repetition within your scripts. For loop is for immediate consecutive actions within a single frame, and do end is for distributed controlled executions over time. Selecting between them depends on the specific needs and timing of your script. While I'll highlight key nodes, I encourage you to explore further. Experiment with different decision-making nodes to see how they influence the execution flow. Now here's a challenge. Test your understanding by opening the tournament bracket template in Effect House. Look at its logic flow and execution order. See how the decision-making nodes affect the sequence. Try explaining this flow in your own words to help you understand it better. Today, we've looked at everything from the basic execution order to decision-making points and the dynamic sequences and loops. You now have the tools you need to make your scripts do exactly what you want. Start exploring these concepts, try different combinations, and see your digital creations become more precise and interactive than ever before. Keep exploring and use visual scripting to bring your ideas to life.